Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to the third session of this very interesting seminar. We'll start this session with addressing the unique issues faced by rare disease community in the face of the pandemic. I'm Dr. Satya. I'm a medical director at Cure Huntington Disease Initiative. So here are my disclosures. I don't have any conflict of interest to disclose, and I will not discuss any off-label use of any products. The outcomes for this topic: we will discuss the challenges faced by the patients and the families with rare disease during COVID-19 pandemic, recognize efforts made by different organizations, whether it be patient organizations or federal organizations, as to how to address the situation. And then I'll describe some recommendations and studies done by academic institutions and physician groups to combat the situation. So I will start with the idea that all situations and challenges are not unique to rare disease. It is a pandemic, these are unprecedented times. Everybody has some kind of challenge that they need to address. What we need to focus on is that rare disease community may have different challenges or more challenges. Some of them may be unique and some of them are just common to all the other challenges that we are facing during this time. And what are some of these unique challenges? First of all, as always, there may be an under-recognition of the rare disorders, such that, say, for a mitochondrial disorder, this may be the first time that they have a significant metabolic load and will react very badly to an infection. And whether the underlying mitochondrial disorders will be recognized or not, that's a question. We have always seen patients with Pompe disease who inadvertently, during a pneumonia or any other chest infection, have acute deterioration and they get diagnosed during those times. And that, again, remains a challenge. Other disorders where immunological systems may be affected or patients may be on immunosuppressive drugs, this may again lead to either under recognition of the situation or not providing adequate care. We have enough stories from patients and families about how some physicians do not know about the medical condition they have. They get answers that they have never heard about it or that certain situations are not possible. And now we are faced with a situation where they are all overworked. They have tremendous load. And now to have another patient where they do not know much about the background of their disorder is certainly an undesirable situation, especially at this time. A lot of patients with rare diseases have multiple systems involved. They require multidisciplinary care, and arranging for this kind of multidisciplinary care during these heavily overloaded hospitals may be a challenge. There are no specific protocols. There's no time to make these protocols. That's certainly a difficult situation for patients and families. The need for new therapies or clinical trials or research is certainly much higher for patients with rare disease, and we are all very aware of that. And therefore, an hindrance to those activities because of the pandemic is more likely to affect rare disease communities than other common disorders for which good therapies may exist, and it may just be an additional therapy that is being researched. And then all the healthcare systems are overloaded. There are not enough beds, there are not enough ICUs, and therefore, the position of the rare disease patient with a rare disease or patients with multiple complicated issues becomes very delicate at this time to make sure that all the care that they receive is provided to them in this very overburdened situation. So just looking at challenges that the patient or a family may face, starting with the personal challenges, and you know, this is certainly not a comprehensive list. I have just tried to enumerate a few that may be the most pressing, but certainly there could be numerous more issues and challenges that patients and families will be facing. So I start off with emotional, because to begin with, most patients with rare diseases and disabilities are anxious about their situations. Families are anxious. They never know what the next week or the next month holds for them. And in this situation, to be faced with a new disease that nobody knows much about, and nobody can say who will be affected, whether they'll be affected or not, what degree they'll be affected, certainly poses a huge emotional challenge for everyone, but especially for patients with chronic disease. And we all have seen the financial downfall from the epidemic in terms of loss of job, loss of employment, and that certainly will not leave any of these families or patients on the side. You know, for a lot of rare disease patients, the small outings that they may have, or small volunteer work that they may be doing, or the visits that they may have to their infusion center really is their social engagement. Their inability to interact with their family and friends in general because of the stay-at-home orders certainly poses a very big social challenge. The family is challenged because they encounter different kind of situations. All children are home now. There is certainly a lot more need for household work, for cooking, for taking care of those, and whether the time required to take care of a person with disabilities or a disease is enough. And there may be a dearth of home health people, or you know, the aid that they may have had before. So I'm sure that that's a huge challenge now. Financial and social situation we already went through. The housing situation will decide how much of social distancing is possible, and things of that nature. The medical care related challenges are also numerous. A number of patients have had their doctor's appointments canceled. We have seen that there are questions about whether drugs will be available, whether adequate equipment will be available, supplies will be available, whether hospital beds will be available. There's a unique situation where testing children for coronavirus has been limited in certain areas, thinking that children are not much affected. Of course, that changed as the epidemic went along. But a lot of patients with rare disease are children, and therefore that may be a conflict for them. And then the medical disorder itself may present challenges like we talked about. It's a multi-system involvement. There is a baseline compromise of respiratory function, maybe cardiac function. The immunity may be lowered inherently because of the disease, like in Gaucher disease, or because of the medications they are on, or because of the immune suppressive therapy that they receive. And so all of this combined produces a very difficult situation for patients with rare disease. There was a NORD survey. They surveyed 772 patients. Almost all were concerned, almost all were impacted. And here you can see the numbers of who had doctor appointments canceled. Almost 30% lost their jobs, and about 11% lost their health insurance because of their job. A similar survey was done in Europe. I think this was also in May. And there are 5,000 families from 993 rare diseases reported. And again, 90% of patients have experienced interruptions in care, either because the hospitals were not available, the doctors were not available, and some of them perceived, 30% of them thought that this could really be life-threatening for them. There's one paper on how COVID has impacted lysosomal storage disorder specifically. There were 102 patients from 16 Italian regions, and there you can see they were about 40 years old, affected by different lysosomal storage disorders as expected. None of them had a COVID infection, but of the people who were receiving infusion therapy, and I'm sorry that the rest of the slide is not really being visualized here, but of those who were receiving infusion therapy, at least 50% did not get one infusion, and about 25% missed more than three infusions. There were a couple of patients who missed infusions for 2 to 3 months, and they did have recurrence of symptoms when the infusion was interrupted for 2 to 3 months. Now, in addition to the patient and the families and their care, this has had an impact on the healthcare organizations and patient organizations. Staff is diverted from research or rare disease patient care to COVID care or to ICUs and to emergency rooms. There is a loss of funding because a lot of research laboratories are closed when the staff is diverted, and there may be an interruption of the research funding. There's difficulty maintaining safe environment for evaluation or therapy, especially for cancers and other very involved therapies. Cancellation of meetings, conferences, a number of patient conferences have been canceled this year. And we all know how great of an event it is for, especially for patients with rare disease, to attend that family meeting every year to get updated about research in that field, to meet the other families, to feel that support. And unfortunately this year, a number of those meetings have been canceled. The fundraising for all the patient organizations is pretty much at a halt at this time. And then on the other hand, with these limitations, the patient organizations have a sudden surge of requests from patients to provide them with support documents, maybe other kinds of support, and overall for patients, families, as well as everybody working in the healthcare and patient organizations. Working from home has been a big issue. People are not accustomed to working from home, having to adjust to that, and then deciding how to allocate their time between family and work and so on. All of these contributes to the general mayhem produced by the pandemic. So I'll talk a little about what we have done. I'm not sure that many of you are familiar, but Cure Huntington Disease Initiative is a research organization. We have preclinical, translational, and clinical research arms. I can talk more about the clinical research arm. We run an observational longitudinal study for Huntington disease that's been ongoing for 7 years. We run it at 168 sites across 4 continents. This is a data cut from earlier this year, and we have 23,000 participants of Huntington disease carriers and controls in the study. And of course, all of those study visits are now at a halt. We also have sub-studies that dwell on the EnrollHD platform. We have a CSF study. We were planning to initiate an imaging study and so on. Some of those efforts have gotten delayed. We will not be receiving data, the annual psychological, neurological, and motor data for these participants. I'm pretty much sure for the rest of the year. But in addition to that, we have had issues related to the sites themselves maintaining their financial and staff integrity. From the pharma side, of course, there has been a huge impact on clinical trials. You know, trials have been paused, they have been deprioritized, canceled, suspended, all of that. And the picture on the right shows how many sites were open to enrollment from March until now. And we started with a drop of about 30%, and really by May, 90% of the sites were closed. And as we can see, with June coming up, the number of sites opening is gradually increasing, and we hope to see that trend in the future months. Now, of course, to address this impact on clinical trials, FDA put out a guidance on the conduct of clinical trials very early in March, and then they revised it in June. And they also have emphasized that patient safety is paramount, and therefore continuing any patient in the study needs to be determined on a case-to-case basis. And they especially emphasize that the patient is discontinued from the study, some additional safety monitoring parameters need to be put in place. They have allowed, or they are considering evaluations, alternative safety evaluations that can be done by phone or that can be done by local labs if the patient cannot travel to the central lab and so on. And there are also steps to see if they can work with the sponsors and allow use of investigational products that can be done without much difficulty if they're home administered or by home nursing or alternative sites can be used. And therefore, they have shown from their side a lot of initiative in making sure that the atmosphere is conducive to continuing research and not cause severe harm to research. From the patient organization side, of course, they have put in a lot of effort to continue to support their own patient groups. A lot of information is available on their sites. They have prepared standard disease information sheets specific for COVID. I think those are very useful. If patients have to go to the hospital, at least they carry those disease information sheets for the local ERs to read about them and decide what kind of care might be appropriate for a particular patient. Patient care organizations are also working with the sponsors to make sure that their disease community or patients are in touch with the progress going on with the clinical trials, and they get regular status updates, and that the patient community is involved in keeping abreast of what's the situation with clinical trials. The Office of Civil Rights, they set out with a bulletin and kind of a reminder for everybody that there cannot be discrimination on the basis of race, color, national origin, disability, age, gender, and exercise of conscience and religion in any of the funded programs. And that they really wanted to make a point that patients with disabilities, and so invariably with rare diseases, cannot be discriminated based on disability, or that the judgment regarding the treatment offered should be made on a case-by-case basis and not based on some stereotype. Then the CMS came out with a number of policy changes. They first of all, they have offered blanket waivers for a number of situations regarding hospital management. A lot of the blanket waivers are in reference to telemedicine, but they're also allowing evaluation of patients away from the sites. They changed their requirements for verbal orders, for requirements for hospital reporting, requirements for compounding of medications, requirements for credentialing of medical staff. It's a 50-page document, so they're really trying to allow hospitals to function better in these times of crises. One of their biggest facilitation, I would say, was they tried to make home infusion services accessible. They tried to change the definition of homebound because somebody who was barely making it to the infusion center may not be able to make it anymore, and they may not have met the previous definition of homebound. And then making it easy to contact with third-party agencies, expanding the access of telehealth. So from their side, they have really tried to make this a little easier for the practitioners as well as the patients. Now, whether all these policy changes from the FDA and CMS will translate to care for everybody remains to be seen. But what really needs to happen, especially with respect to therapies and available of supplies for this for the rare disease patients, is that making sure that all the infusions and injections are covered as a home infusion therapy. And then there is also coverage of supplies and equipment, not just the drugs, and it's not that the patient incurs expenses for other things required for the infusion. And then make the access to telehealth home infusion for a while, even after the country returns to normal, though I'm not sure what that actually means. Returning to normal, that seems like a very far off thing. But continue the access to these to these services for a period of time and not cut short on them as soon as everything appears to be improving. And then there was a very good point raised of what is considered as elective procedures and surgeries, and maybe a new definition of that. Because for in some instances, yes, the surgery may be elective, but deferring it for months and months may not be really an appropriate thing. So a new definition or application of these definitions to different populations appropriately. And that brings us to some of the guidelines. And I just chose a few guidelines just to highlight how different disorders are differently affected by the situation and how the guidelines may differ among them. So for example, for the blood disorders, their guidelines are relatively focused on blood transfusions and bone marrow transplantations. And of course, they are saying that bone marrow transplantations should be postponed, obviously, because a patient needs to be immune suppressed or maybe immune ablated for a bone marrow transplantation, and that may not be advisable during these times of COVID. And so their whole focus is on making minimum outpatient visits, making sure that blood transfusion programs are continued and that exposure to COVID is minimized. Whereas for neuromuscular disease patients, it's a very involved and a very difficult situation, mostly for a few reasons. One being that they are on, they could be on steroids or immune suppressants, for example, patients with myasthenia gravis. And now it's a twofold situation. If they continue the immune suppressant, whether the risk of infection goes up, but certainly with an infection, they could be in an acute myasthenic crisis, for example. And so therefore, unless there is a manifestation of COVID, the recommendation is to continue the immune suppression therapy. And the organizations have tried to offer different kinds of rehabilitation programs and exercises, even online. And then recommendations regarding use of hydroxychloroquine or azithromycin for treatment of COVID, and pay attention to the risk of exacerbation of myasthenia or QT prolongation. But I think the biggest challenge for neuromuscular patients is patients with very compromised pulmonary function or those who are already on ventilatory support or those who have already have significant neuromuscular compromise, for example, ALS patients, in the face of COVID, whether they should get further therapy or not. And that seems to be the most challenging issue for neuromuscular patients. And what kind of resuscitative measures could be applied? And how could a fairest medical decision be made? And so they have essentially listed conditions or situations where this can be made. And they do encourage the use of non-invasive ventilation to support these patients. The guidelines, for example, for oncology patients are very different because most of the patients are immunocompromised or immunosuppressed. And for them, strict control of infection and preventing exposure of the patient to the infection is of highest priority. And in general, the recommendation is to try to delay if the patient has already not been on chemotherapeutic agents or treatment for cancer, to delay those cancer therapies. And in situations where patients put on infusions, but if there is an alternative medication, an oral medication is available, then they should be on it. And there was one paper that said that patients who were on active cancer therapy were four times more likely of having a severe infection, especially if they don't receive those therapy in the previous 14 days of the COVID diagnosis. And then again, just similar to other rare diseases, the ability of a patient suffering from cancer to get all the care required for him if he or she were to contract COVID-19 in the current situation of an overwhelmed healthcare system is a major risk factor for the patient. And then again, making drive-through drug, picking up of drugs, having labs go home and draw blood and things like that, which will be helpful to reduce exposure of these patients. And then again, patients who had a surgery for cancer and then contracted COVID-19 were at more risk of having a more severe disease. So that again, if possible, surgeries should be delayed. And then again, always with the mind that an ICU bed may not be available post-surgical. So really there has been a very strict or a stringent guideline regarding how to operate on cancer patients during the COVID-19 pandemic. And evidence suggests that 60 days delays in early breast cancer may not worsen oncological outcomes. So there is couple of studies that point out that maybe delaying for a few days may not be that detrimental to the patient. I think that brings us to the end of my talk. We have seen what kind of situations patients might be facing and how different agencies, including patient care organizations or federal agencies and healthcare organizations, physician organizations are trying to address these issues either by recommendations or by providing additional facilities or by facilitating home infusions and so on. And hopefully this translates to something very meaningful for the rare disease patients. Thank you.